Hello and welcome to another edition of Door County Today. I'm your host, Paul Renier of Door County Nature and Travel. After a long winter, it's finally June on the peninsula, a time of renewal and rebirth in nature and for the county's tourism. Today, we'll visit the farm just north of Sturgeon Bay. It's a recreation of our pioneer past where kids can pet a piglet or feed a lamb. You can also tour log cabins and other structures of Door County's agricultural heritage. Next, we'll take a shoreline boat ride with Fish Creek Scenic Boat Tours. Their guided tours are one of the most interesting ways to explore the county's history and geography. Afterwards, we'll explore Northern Door's Hotz Trail, a hiking trail in Newport State Park, Wisconsin's only wilderness-designated state park. Finally, you'll meet Norbert Blei, Door County's celebrated writer who recently passed away. This In Memoriam segment will introduce you to a writer who you'll want to know more about and lead you to read one of his eloquent books about the people and landscapes of the Door Peninsula. So, let's start this month's show with a visit to the farm.
This is the 47th year of the farm.
The farm was a vision of four families that started back in 1965. Their names were Carl Schultz, Orv Schopp, George Evenson, and Ralph Roth. Carl and Orv ran it for 30-some years. And finally, it got too much for them, so they called up my son Dave and wanted to know if he'd be interested in taking over the farm, because Dave worked for Carl and Orv through high school and college.
And our family, the Tank family, is now owns the farm. It's my husband and myself, my two sons, Jeff and David, and my son David's wife, Jenny.
The farm, actually what it represents is of rural America. How it was started, you know, many years ago from settlers and stuff like that. And so they had a vision of finding all these log cabins and all that stuff, antiques, which was, a lot of families say we do have a lot of interesting antiques that they don't see at a lot of other museums.
What this is a 1923 Model T Ford pickup truck. And what it was used for at the farm here is when they purchased it, they used to take it to parades to advertise the farm and stuff like that. And in the back, on the bed of the truck, they used to put little kid goats with little children in it. And they'd say, a load of kids from the farm. So. That's what they use it for.
Here we have a tractor, an antique now, and we have many come and they can sit on, especially the boys come and sit on the tractor, and many parents and grandparents say they never moved from the spot. They stayed on that tractor all the while they were at the farm.
This tractor here, this Fortson tractor, came from my cousin up in West Jacksonport, and what I can remember as a child, we used to sit outside, and we used to sit on it like the kids do at the farm here today. This used to be what the big cherry growers used to have, and that used to be your drinking water for the pickers and that stuff. So, they used to call it the water wagon.
And one thing I really enjoy about it is when the families come with their children, how the children can interact with the animals, the little animals in the petting area.
We've got some corn we're going to feed. We'll feed that a little later as we go along. I think we'll take a walk into the young stock barn now and show everybody a little bit what's going on. Let me see what time it is. It's 11 o'clock, and you know what that means? It's goat milking time.
As we're milking the goats, the mother or the dad will say to the child, now you see where milk comes from? The child will say the milk comes from the store. It does not come from the goat or the cow, you know. So that's kind of interesting.
Here we have some little piglets here. They're about a week and a half old. And they take the bottles. They're two, but there's 10 more over in the other pen. So their mom has 12 little babies. And these are little ones, some of our little goats right here. And they're only, some of them are not even 2 weeks old yet. So they're pretty small. And it's feeding time. Feeding time at the farm today. She's a pretty busy mom. We never have enough kittens. Isn't this a nice one? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Bet you'd like to take this one home, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
We do have an adoption program for our kittens, and that works out quite well. And so they're a highlight at the farm, aren't they? And the farm is on 40 acres, and we have beautiful trails in the woods, and there's just, and you can do a lot at the farm. We have one of our new animals named Jerry, which is a Brahmin, and that's a, oh, it's a big animal.
One big thing that I've noticed when I was growing up as a child, there was a lot of family farms. I mean, where children could go and visit with their aunts, their uncles, grandpas and grandmas, and they could go work on the, in the summertime on the farm. Them days are gone because now what the farms are getting fewer and fewer, and you have your mega farms. So parents that do bring their children here think it is a great idea that we have here for them to get the hands-on experience. So I know I had two cousins from Chicago that would come up every summer and help us on the farm, you know, make hay and stuff like that, and they really thought it was great. So, but that experience for a lot of children nowadays is gone.
Hello, and welcome to another edition of The Natural Door. I'm Paul Renier from Door County Nature and Travel. Door County has hundreds of miles of hiking opportunities in its state and county parks, land trust properties, and private preserves. Today we're going to visit Newport State Park and do the Hotz Trail. These large pillars, found at the trailhead of the Hotz Trail, were once the main entrance to the Ferdinand Hotz Cottage, located between Europe Lake and Lake Michigan on a very large sand dune. For additional information on the history of Newport State Park, visit the park headquarters for the brochure Newport Out of Wilderness into Wilderness. Inside the brochure, you'll find historical photographs of the Hotz estate and also excerpts from Ferdinand Hotz Jr. The Hotz Trail takes hikers on a walk through deciduous and coniferous trees on fairly level ground to rolling hills. The rolling hills are a result of ancient sand dunes that were formed at one time to separate Europe Lake and Lake Michigan. You know, one of the really neat things about some of these trails, and it's just a perfect example here, is these tree canopied trails. The trees just come over the top, forming these tunnels of just pure vegetation. I just find this wonderful. Each species kind of has its own personality. A little pinkish cast of this beautiful red pine here, the gnarliness and the lichen-covered bark of this white pine, young white pine. And there up above, you can see a tree that was injured at some time and has compensated for that injury and has taken another path and grown on. Unfortunately, trees die. Here we see a tree that's fallen over, never reached the forest floor because of all the trees in the way. But the death of trees are really important to the health and future of this forest. It provides homes for insects and decomposers, and later on it'll turn into soil and enrich the soil for future trees to grow and other plants to grow upon. A group of plants that interest lots of people are called ferns, and there are about a dozen ferns you could find in Door County in its forests. Here we see a fairly common fern called a bracken fern, found quite often along trails edges or in forest open areas. Depending on the habitat, depends on what species of fern grows there. Well, here we see one of our coniferous trees that we find in Door County. Quite often, the eastern hemlock will grow in groves in the forest. You'll see not just a single tree, but sometimes a dozen to two dozen of these huge trees. The Hotz Trail does walk through one of these large stands of eastern hemlock. This is one of our biggest trees that we'll find in our deciduous forest, along with the white pine being the largest of all pines that we find here. And it's kind of ironic, here we see this is a fairly large tree right here, but it can get 2 to 3 times the size of this individual specimen, but it sports one of the smallest cones of all the trees, the coniferous trees. They're only about a half inch to 3/4 inch long, and the needles are about anywhere from 3/8 to 1/2 inch long, are generally quite dark green, whereas other coniferous trees, it could be a little yellowish green, but this one has a definite dark green effect to it, and having very small cones. The white pine is a native North American tree that helped put the upper Midwest and the Northeast on the map. Literally, the white pine covered the northeast part of the United States. Trees that you could put 3 grown men around and holding hands, which would equal their circumference, they were huge. Today's trees, which are very tall in our current forests, they look very big, but are mere youngsters compared to those of the early settlement of the New World. In Wisconsin, billions of board feet of white pine were cut. It was known as white gold back in those days and helped to fuel the growth of the western expansion of the United States, cities of Minneapolis, Chicago, Kansas City, to build those communities. If you look at the needles of the white pine, you'll notice that there are 5 needles in a bundle, and they're about 2.5 to 3 inches long. But every year, coniferous trees, or what we call evergreens, really lose some of their leaves, some of their needles, and they will have what we call a needle drop. You can see a little bit of the yellowing in some of these trees and amongst the evergreen nature, and those yellow needles will drop. I'm standing on the location where Ferdinand Hotz had his cabin. It was located on a large sand dune that separates Lake Michigan from Europe Lake. This short trail takes us to the boathouse on Europe Lake, and we know that because the rock that has been placed here was placed here in a very stepstone type fashion, and it's also the shelf rock that we would not find in a sand dune that once covered this area exclusively. Due to the fact that the lake level is so low on Europe Lake, it's exposed all this rock that was brought in for cribbing and forming the foundation of the boathouse. We didn't finish the Hotz Trail today. Hopefully you can try and finish that someday on your own. Join us again on The Natural Door and visit us often on DoorCountyToday.com. I'm Paul Renier. See you next time.
If you have been to Door County before and you've never been out on the water in Door County, then shame on you. It is the absolute way to see Door County. It's what Door County is all about. We're surrounded by water. That's what put us on the map. And when you view Door County from the other side, it's an interesting perspective of what things looked like hundreds of years ago. There's beautiful, untapped natural resources in caves and bluffs and trees. This is some of the oldest trees throughout this Niagara Escarpment in the eastern United States. It's really incredible. This boat was built in Marinette Marine in 1962, so it's a local boat. It is 53 feet long, 16 feet wide. It drafts about 4 feet empty. It's all steel. It has been running trips out of Fish Creek since it was brand new. It's the only thing it's ever done. The boat has been completely refurbished a few years ago. We do have microphones and a sound system on board, so everyone throughout the boat can hear really well. But it's still not such a big boat that there's not multiple levels. You're not gonna get lost in the boat. It's somewhat cozy, but 69 passengers, plenty of room. Typically, we cut it off at about 55 to 60 people, just so everyone has enough space to move around and feel comfortable with the ride. When I started Sister Bay Boat Rental, one of the biggest complaints I got was people with kids, families would come to Door County and there just wasn't enough to do. So what we decided to do at Fish Creek Scenic Boat Tours is offer free passage for all the kids. So kids ride for free. When they come aboard, we give them a little captain's hat, which fits kids. Then their parents can take their picture, they can drive the boat, they get to pull the horn. It's really exciting for the kids. Our way to help out families and get them on board and get them out to see things and give the kids a little fun. One of our goals when you get on the boat is we want to educate you. We want you to walk off learning something new that day. And we have a lot of information that we've researched and studied from Door County's past. There's some very interesting historical things that have happened here in Door County, shipwrecks, past mansions like Englemar on Horseshoe Island. A lot of information that you'll get on the tour that you probably, even if you're a native of Door County like myself, have never known. We have several different people that crew for us at Fish Creek Scenic Boat Tours. Tom is the former superintendent from the Peninsula State Park. He was there for 27 years. Anything you want to know about the Peninsula State Park, Tom is our resident expert. We also have Marsha, which is a former school teacher, so she's very used to giving instruction and giving people information and educating folks on the nuances of Door County. We also have some younger narrators that have come in and kind of bring a fresh energy and really relate to a different demographic on board. It's a good idea to call our office and make reservations. Sometimes we deviate from our normal schedule every day, so you just want to make sure we're running that 1 o'clock, 3 o'clock, or 7 o'clock. Late August, September, and October, the sunset starts setting earlier, so then our 7 o'clock sunset live music trip starts departing earlier. So you want to make sure you call ahead, get a reservation, find out when the boat's leaving for sure so you don't miss it. At 1 p.m. every day, we're going to go out on a Peninsula State Park and Ephraim North cruise. We're going to leave Fish Creek. At 1 p.m., we're going to run along the 7 miles of cobblestone shoreline of the Peninsula State Park. You're going to see the Eagle Bluff Lighthouse. We're also going to go past Eagle Cave. You're going to get to see the Indian Head up in the Niagara Escarpment, which is just a really neat scene. You'll see Eagle Tower. We'll duck into Ephraim. You get the history of Ephraim and how the Moravians kind of started out that town. And then we'll circle back into Fish Creek. Right after that trip at 3 p.m., we also offer a Millionaire's Row and West Islands cruise. On that cruise, we're going to run south out of Fish Creek, and we're going to run along Millionaire's Row and see all the mansions and beautiful homes up along the shoreline. We're also going to cut through the islands past the nesting grounds of the rock pile. We're going to cut through the Strawberry Islands. You get to hear the history of all the girls and boys camps that have happened over the years on the Strawberry Islands. You're going to see, you know, talk about who owned it, who owns it now, what homes are on there and why. We'll go back and we'll look at the Eagle Bluff Lighthouse. We'll learn about the 145-year-old history of that lighthouse and how it matches its sister lighthouse on Chambers Island and why it was built and how that used to help direct ships to navigate through Green Bay. And at 7 o'clock every night, we do a sunset live music trip. We'll have live music on board. We'll change up different music genres depending on our audience. And you're welcome to bring whatever you want to eat or drink on board. Sit back, relax, and we'll go out for a beautiful sunset in Door County.
My name is Norb Blei, and I'm a writer. Been living here since 1969, came from Chicago. I wrote fiction and nonfiction. I came to the county with the idea of leaving all that behind me, although I had to exist via Chicago for at least 10 years. By driving back and forth and doing stories and continuing to freelance, but really to focus then more on books was the reason I came here. This was a nice, quiet place to work. I had to then slowly adjust to life here and my whole life as a writer.
I have a voice and an attitude and appreciation of people that causes them to open up almost immediately and talk. If you can get people to trust you, and either they see that immediately or they don't, and if they do, they'll tell you more than you want to know. And when I would do a profile of a person, I would always try to not just talk about the person, but tell a story about them, tell a story about my coming to meet him or whatever. You want this thing to say something, make this life exhibit some sense of meaning, you know. I really try to take word for word what a person said. I don't fashion any of the conversation. I don't edit. Whatever was down there is a revelation of who that person was.
as I began to write about the place, my attraction then was to get as close to the person who was still farming, the person who still had an orchard. I think the first one was my next door neighbor, Charlie Root, who was in his 80s at that time and had, I think, only left the county once in his entire life. But he became my really close friend. And then the Carlsons across the road, and I always call him Pa, and he, in fact, worked on this place. He cut all the lumber for this coop of mine where I'm in now. But Pa Carlson and Charlie, these were some of the first people. And Charlie would be the epitome of the old-timer, rough life, just eking a living out on a small piece of land. After I had maybe five or six, I began scoping the county itself, thinking, who are the women that would be interesting? Women who might represent a real sense of independence. I had Chick Peterson that I got to know, and he became a very good friend of mine and has done all the covers on my books and many illustrations as well. Al Johnson, how could you do a story about business in this county without centering maybe that story about him and what he was able to build there? The work then became an accumulation of these stories into a book, an expression of these people and why they were here, what they were doing here, and the kind of lives that they led. When we come in here, writers, artists, photographers, and we see the county through different eyes, does the local see what we see, you know, or are they just so enmeshed in what their life is that they're oblivious to all this? I can almost hear the quiet. At times I think I live in a poem. Early walks toward the lake at the end of the road find me merging into solemn woods, into fields on fire in morning light, drifting toward shimmering lake water, waiting in repose for my approach. I have been trying to define this place for more than 40 years, my adopted landscape. I came to believe this peninsula was all about light 10 years after I settled in 1969, and continue to study my new setting since then in notes, essays, and books, trying to acclimate myself to a rural culture utterly foreign to me. I walked and walked the immediate area around my old farmhouse those first years, always a stranger in my own domain. What is this? Is this home? The writer at large, attempting to settle in once again, acquainting himself with the nearby fields, the woods, the stone fences, the inland waters, Lake Michigan and Green Bay shoreline. I drove the back roads north and south, up and down the peninsula, crisscrossed it in all kinds of weather and all seasons, and I never tired of all it offered. 40 years later, I remain in place, though looking at everything from different angles. There is something about this peninsula I still need to know. The land is always telling me something, and I am trying hard to concentrate, to listen, to get it right. Reading the landscape at the beginning was a new and very different book to comprehend, to learn, to translate in one's own words.
Thanks for joining us today. Remember to come back often to find out more about Door County's history, landscapes, businesses, and people. For updated information about this beautiful peninsula, visit DoorCountyToday.com. I'm Paul Renier for Door County Today. See you next time.